The scriptures we're going to be sharing tonight come to us from Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 2. And we're going to read the first 12 verses of Matthew chapter 2. So if you have your Bible, feel free to open it to Matthew chapter 2, or if you have a Bible on your phone or on another application. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born, King of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and we've come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. And they told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them the time that the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you found him, bring word that I too may come and worship him." And after listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where he was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. And then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. Here ends our gospel reading. In that reading, it talked about the men being led by the light of the star. We have a star up here, but right now it's not lit. So we're going to light that before we start the message. Something to focus on this week. Talk about this text tonight. Please join me in word prayer. Well, Lord, thank you for bringing us here tonight and this opportunity to reflect on your word as we think about the Christmas story and this aspect of it that Matthew shares with us in his gospel. We pray that you would encourage us and strengthen us in realizing just what it is that you've done for us in Christmas. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I hope you had a great Christmas, because just as you came in and the Christmas tree was not lit, yours may not even be up anymore. Christmas is over. Officially over. As of Friday. Did you know that? Friday was Epiphany. January 6th. And so that signals the end of Christmas. It's the end of the 12 days. That's where the 12 days of Christmas comes from. It comes from that time between Christmas and Epiphany. And Epiphany happened on Friday. And that's why we have silly little carols about the 12 days of Christmas. And we had a carol sing Sunday last week here at Holy Cross. It was in the morning on New Year's Day. And anybody could pick out of the hymnal carols that they hadn't sung yet around Christmas, and they could offer it as a suggestion for us to sing. And I'm sure there might have been some people who were looking through there hoping to find that 12 Days of Christmas song. Where is that 12 Days of Christmas one in there? You know, the one about what your true love gives you for Christmas, and there are 12 pipers piping and 11 drummers drumming, and 10 lords are leaping, and 9 ladies dancing, 8 maids are milking, 7 swans swimming, 6 geese laying, 5 golden rings, 4 calling birds, 3 French hens, 2 turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. Out of all of that, there's only one thing that's any good that any of us would even want anyway, isn't there? So if that's really what our true love is giving us for Christmas, I'll settle for one day of Christmas, please. At just the 5 golden rings. But that hymn is not in our hymnal. And the reason it's not in our hymnal, it's because none of those gifts really have anything to do with the purpose of Christ's coming anyway. Even though, in what I just read to you from Matthew chapter 2, we do hear about some people bringing gold to Jesus. And speaking of carols that aren't in our hymnal here at Holy Cross, there's another one called We Three Kings of Orientar. That one nobody would have found last week in our hymn sing Sunday either for a carol sing, because it's not there. And yet there's a carol that was written about 150 years ago, and it was written just for this text. It was written for the coming of these kings in a Christmas pageant in New York City. And so that so they could celebrate the coming of the kings into the Christmas story, taking their place next to the shepherds and worshiping the newborn king. Except they weren't really there the night that Jesus was born. Except we don't know that there was actually three of them. There were three gifts, but we don't know how many of them came. Except that, were they really kings? Or were they not kings? What I read to you said wise men. Are they wise men? Or are they kings? Since we are so close to Epiphany, it was just 2 days ago. And since actually in the history of the church, Epiphany was celebrated as a time to celebrate the birth of Jesus, even before December 25th was ever considered to be Christmas, I thought it would be good for us to spend some time in those texts for today. And so spend some time thinking about Epiphany. And so we're going to look at that from Matthew's Gospel, what I just read to you, and you can look through it too if you want to. We're going to start at chapter 2, verse 1, and we're going to see why does Matthew, the only one of the Gospel writers to include this aspect of the Christmas story for us. What is it we have to learn from what he has to share with us here? So we'll start at verse 1. It's where Matthew says in chapter 2 that after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him. Already there in the first verse, the translators of the English Standard Version that we're using here at Holy Cross have had to make a translation choice. And they're following a pattern that was set 400 years ago in some of the first English translations, for example, what you find in the King James Version, by calling these people wise men who came to find Jesus. But newer translations, well, not newer than this, but newer than the King James Version, like the New International Version, if you have the NIV, you'll notice do something different. Instead of translating that word, they simply give us, as close as they can, the Greek term, and they call them magi. And they say that magi came from the east. That's simply a way of saying the Greek word in English. And so, if they're not kings, and they're not wise men, or perhaps they could be wise men, they're really magi, but that doesn't mean much to us. What is a magi? Well, the only other place in the Bible that magi show up, and it's in the Greek translation of the Old Testament, is in the second chapter of Daniel. And in the second chapter of Daniel, the magi are lumped together with the astrologers and the magicians and the sorcerers of Babylon. And in the English translations, often they're translated as enchanter. And they're lumped together with the astrologers, the magicians, and the sorcerers because King Nebuchadnezzar has been having insomnia. King Nebuchadnezzar is not able to sleep. He's been having a reoccurring dream night after night that's keeping him up. And so he summons all his magicians and astrologers and sorcerers and magi, the enchanters, and tells them he wants them to interpret his dream. And if they're not able to interpret his dream, and then he's going to tear them limb from limb, and he's going to burn down their houses, all of them. Except here's the catch. In order to make sure that they truly interpret his dream and aren't just feeding him a line, he's not willing to tell them what his dream was. They have to first tell him what he's been dreaming about, and then they have to interpret the dream for him. Now, no matter how wise these magi might have been, they're not wise enough to do that, and they know it. And so in Daniel chapter 2, verse 10, they say to the king in complaint, they say, no one on earth can do what the king demands. This thing he is asking for is too difficult. The only one who can show this to the king are the gods, and they do not dwell in the flesh. Daniel chapter 2, verses 10 to 11. Daniel heard about this. And so Daniel went to the king, and Daniel pleaded with the king to give him time to be able to interpret the dream. And the king, Nebuchadnezzar, said he could have a night to think about it. And so he went back, and he began praying to the Lord for insight and understanding to be able to interpret the dream, and the Lord gave it to him. And the next day, he went back to King Nebuchadnezzar, and he told him he could interpret the dream. And he explained to him what the dream was, and he explained to him the interpretation sufficiently enough that all of the magi in Babylon were saved. And what was the dream about? But the dream was about all of the kingdoms that would rise and fall after Babylon until God would finally set up one king who would reign forever without end. Now perhaps that story of the day that Daniel's God saved the Magi, which passed down from generation to generation, from father to son to grandchild, among the Magi for centuries, for some 400 years, until the day when some Magi off in the east, somewhere near Babylon, looked up in the sky and saw a new star over what he thought to be Jerusalem, and thought that perhaps Nebuchadnezzar's dream and the Lord's interpretation of it was finally coming true. That this was the king that was being dreamt about, who was being born over the city where Daniel had been born. There was a star. And so perhaps this is the king that Daniel spoke of that was going to reign forever and ever. And perhaps that happened. I mean, there's no way of knowing what it was that piqued the curiosity of these Magi and had them travel from the east. And there's no way of really knowing whether they're actually related in some way to those Magi in Daniel chapter 2. But one thing's for certain that they did not understand is they didn't realize that the Magi's word from Daniel chapter 2 verses 10 and 11 was actually coming true. You see, in Daniel 2, 10, 11, the Magi said, "No one on earth could show this to the king except the gods, and they do not dwell in the flesh." I saw that star in the sky over Jerusalem. That's the night that came true. Because John 1:14 says, he became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And so that might have been lost on the Magi. It was lost on Herod too. And that's why when they came to see Herod, Herod is all the more troubled about the Magi's presence. And so we follow up in verse 3. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him, and assembling the chief priests and the scribes and the people, he inquired where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it's written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod summoned the wise men and secretly ascertained from them what time the star had appeared." Takes us down through verse 7. See, these wise men, Magi, may have been actually wise enough for kings to consult them about things like their insomnia, but they're not truly wise in the ways of God. They're not wise in the matters of things that really eternally matter. They're not wise enough to know where this Christ is actually supposed to be born. And so they just are looking for him in Jerusalem because that seems to be where the star appeared, and perhaps they knew that was where Daniel had been born. But they didn't know where he was truly going to be born, and so the wisdom had to be shared with them through the prophet Micah. Here's what the Lord's wisdom says through the prophet. He would be born in Bethlehem. And so in the next verse, verse 8, Herod sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go search diligently for the child. When you found him, bring word that I may too come and worship him." And after listening to the king, they went on their way. Behold, the star they saw when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. You see, they might be very wise in the ways of the Lord, but they're also not very wise in the ways of people or in understanding people's intentions either. Because up until this point in the story, they seem to assume that King Herod has the same intentions they do, that he's as interested in worshiping this child as they are. And that's exactly what they're doing. And so in verse 11, when they go into the house and they see Mary and the child with his mother, they fall down and worship him. And opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. But God finds ways to circumvent the simple-minded like these Magi, just as he did back in the days of Daniel. Had to find ways to circumvent the simple-mindedness of the Magi who couldn't interpret the dream he had given Nebuchadnezzar. So here too, he has to find a way around the simple-mindedness of the Magi by giving them a dream that even a Magi couldn't help but be able to interpret. And he gives them a dream and warns them, do not go back to Herod. And so in verse 12, that's the end of our lesson. They return to their own country by a different way. Now that's where what our reading was ended, but Matthew continues and explains why it was they needed to depart by another way. Because Herod's intentions never were to worship this child. His intentions from the very beginning were to kill the Christ child. And so when the Magi didn't return and give him the exact identity of this Christ child, he sent swordsmen into Bethlehem to kill every child 2 years and under, according to the time he had ascertained about when the star appeared from the Magi. But Mary and Joseph and the child were already safely on their way out of the country to Egypt because God had warned them in a dream too. You see, when Matthew introduces these folks in chapter 2, verse 1, Matthew does it with words of surprise, words of shock, words of awe. He says, "Behold, Magi came from the east to Jerusalem." The word "behold" is a word of surprise. It should be, "Look, look who's coming. Can you believe this? Can you believe Magi are coming?" Because these are people who are not wise in the things of God. They're not wise in things that eternally matter. And here they are fulfilling the wisdom of God that's been shared ever since the days of the prophets, like Isaiah, who said in Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1, "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you." And then in verse 3 it says, "And nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising." And then in verse 6 it says, "And they shall bring frankincense and gold and good news, the praises of the Lord." So why is it that these Magi are bringing frankincense and gold to Jesus in this text? Is it because that's a part of the Babylonian 12 Days of Christmas carol? No, it's because it's part of Isaiah's celebrative carols about the coming of Messiah that were written decades and years, even over a century before even Daniel was born. And it's Isaiah, in that Isaiah 60 text, who also talked about kings coming to the brightness of his rising. And that's probably where this association came from around Epiphany, to call these Magi, these wise men, kings. It's probably from that prophecy of Isaiah. But in the scope of Matthew's gospel, in the flow of what he's writing, he's not writing about these Magi in order for us to be in awe about the great and powerful people that were bowing down to the child Jesus. Instead, Matthew's writing it in order for us to be reminded of how we all come to worship Jesus. Jesus is going to go on to say later in Matthew's gospel, in chapter 11, verse 27, "No one knows the Father except the Son, and no one knows the Son except the Father and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him." Matthew 11, 27. In other words, none of us come to the Lord by our own wisdom. None of us come as those who are wise. We all come in the way of the Magi. We come as those who are unwise. Unwise in the ways of God. And those who have been made wise by the Spirit of the Son. We've been made wise in the things of God that truly matter. We've been made wise in the ways of salvation. Paul talks about this too. So Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 is writing to a group of believers who are arguing about who's the wisest. And about who's the wisest leader among them. Which leader should they all follow? And Paul, in writing to them in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 19, he says, "It is written, I shall destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. For where is the wise one? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the wise? Since in the wisdom of God the world could not know God by wisdom, God was pleased by the foolishness of what we preach to save those who believe. For the Jews demand a sign, and the Greeks seek wisdom. But for those who are called, both Greeks and Jews, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God." That's 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 19 through 24. And then Paul picks up again just a couple verses later as he goes into chapter 2. And he says, "Therefore, brothers and sisters, I have not come to you with words of lofty wisdom and powerful speech, but I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And therefore I was among you in weakness and in fear and in trembling. And my words and my message were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, and then in verse 10 he says, and God has revealed these things to us by his Spirit. And so brothers and sisters in Christ today, I'm not up here to give you any lofty words of wisdom. Instead, to give you a message about Jesus Christ and him crucified. And interestingly enough, that little carol I mentioned at the beginning of this message that was written by John Henry Hopkins about the coming of the three kings, we three kings of Orient are, that's exactly what he does with that carol. It was written 150 years ago in 1857 for a pageant in New York, a Christmas pageant. And when he wrote it, not only did he talk about the three kings of the Orient who came to worship Jesus, but he also then put in the words of those magi everything that we believe about Jesus. He takes those who were truly unwise and he writes it as if they had become wise in the way that you and I have become wise. He writes it as if they had become wise by the Spirit to know the things of God, to know why this Christ child really came. And so in your folder for tonight, there is a little blue sheet, and I invite you to take that out. And on that blue sheet, you see some of those words. You see the first verse, which is very familiar to all of us. We three kings of Orient are, bearing gifts we traverse afar, field and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star. And then there's the refrain. But then verse 2 begins to talk about the gifts they bring. Verse 2 talks about the bringing of the gold. And notice in there that he winds in this theme of Jesus being the king who will reign forever, which is exactly what Daniel interpreted King Nebuchadnezzar's dream to be in Daniel chapter 2. And then look at verse 3. It's the one about the frankincense. He talks about frankincense and winds in there about this magi sharing the frankincense and also talking about this being God in the flesh, which is what the Magi in Daniel 2 said could never happen, and yet in this verse it says there is a deity nigh. In other words, God has come. And then in the next verse, it's the verse about the myrrh, which was something that Isaiah didn't mention in his prophecy. So why is there myrrh being brought? Well, this Magi who brings it knows that it's being brought because it's a bitter spice, and it would begin to make us think of the Lord's passion, about his death and his crucifixion on our behalf, for our sins. And then there's only three gifts, but there's yet another verse. And that fifth verse is a verse about resurrection. It's about the rising of our Lord Jesus. It's a verse about Easter. Easter at Christmas? Yeah, because that's why Jesus came. And so what I'd like to do here at the end of the sermon, John Henry Hopkins did such a great job of pulling that all together and putting it into this message of the Magi. And it's just a simple message of Jesus Christ and him crucified for us. I thought we'd spend some time reflecting on that together. And we'll do that by singing it together. And so I'm just going to play it up here on acoustic guitar. And we'll just join together in singing it. And I don't have the best voice, but I imagine that you can help me carry the tune. And we'll make it happen. So we're going to sing We Three Kings of Orient Are. And one thing we're going to do is, as we sing this together, we're going to sing all the verses, but we won't sing the refrain after the last verse. So the last verse is the one about resurrection. And we're just going to let that end with Alleluia, Alleluia, earth to the heaven replies. We'll just end with that instead of putting a refrain on the end of it. Stop. Lord, in the same way you brought us to yourself, through the work of your Spirit, keep us in that faith now and